Okay, so let's move on to this asset management use case. It's a series of papers that are forthcoming at the moment in this Journal of Financial Data Science. One of the papers is called Interpretable Machine Learning for Diversified Portfolio Construction, because obviously we build upon the work of Marcos López de Prado on the hierarchical risk parity and introduce a little bit of interpretable machine learning. The other one is basically an extension of that work, really inspired by the core GAN approach of Gauthier's. And the third one is actually not listed because it's still in production, but it's all around synthetic data generation, hierarchical risk parity, and explainable. So this is the idea basically. So we were inspired in this work by Marcos López de Prado, obviously, by Gauthier, obviously, and also by Rosario Mantegna, who was one of the first around 20 years ago to apply complex systems methodologies to financial data. So there's a great paper around using hierarchical clustering, graph analysis like minimal spanning trees to financial time series. So it's really worth reading that. And I think Gauthier has a huge paper with some colleagues really summarizing all the papers that have been elaborated in the past 20 years around clustering hierarchies and all these things. So it's really the best overview I'm aware of at the moment.
Thanks, Johan. I'll post it in the chat, but thanks for the...
Cool. Okay. Yeah, that's good. Okay. And the team basically, so it was a four-year collaboration with Munich Re Markets team. Munich Re is a large reinsurance company and also insurance company based out of Munich with global operations. And they also have an investment branch, obviously. And so Munich Re Markets is the capital markets section here. And specifically worked with Stefan Krügel and Markus Jäger on this. And this work is still ongoing, so it's a long project, and we permanently get new input, new ideas, and ways to extend the work. Now, obviously, for speeding up things, but also new experiments coming up in the pipeline. So, and also collaborating with Peter Schwendner, who's a professor at the Zurich University of Applied Sciences. He's also a capital market expert. And also working with Dimi Marinelli, who joined us out of a funding by EU. So we call this approach in the marketing speak a triple AI, because we use a pipeline of different machine learning AI approaches, basically. So obviously we look at the hierarchical risk parity performance, and we want to understand basically how or in which data situation this model works really well. And sometimes maybe also find a data situation where you should go for another model like equal risk contribution or the naive risk parity approach or some or most diversified portfolio. So all these risk-based portfolio construction algorithms can be analyzed in this framework and compared to hierarchical risk parity. In most cases that we analyzed, HRP, hierarchical risk parity, was really the most robust one. So we need some data to run our Monte Carlo experiments and these analysis of performance superiority of hierarchical risk parity. So in the first, as a starting point, let's say, we used simple block bootstrapping. So we take some empirical data and we create more data out of this and strip it. And then we measure the performance of this backtest. And in the end, we can use the properties of the bootstrap data as an input to a machine learning model and the outperformance of hierarchical risk parity as an output of a machine learning model. So this is really the labels basically that can be trained. So you can arrange a setup for XGBoost and then using the SHAP values, to explain the model. So that means we are able to explain to a certain extent the driving properties of a data set, driving in terms of what's driving the performance or the outperformance of hierarchical risk parity. So that's really the idea. Okay. So in this, it's like a new workflow, let's say, that is quite obvious to use because explainable AI can help to better understand the links. I mean, it's not really explaining, it's just looking at the feature importance, right? It's not causality. I think in the second talk, we really hear something about causality. Yeah. So just for those who are not familiar with HRP, so it basically takes the covariance correlation matrix and creates hierarchical cluster structure. And then once you have this cluster structure, it's possible to come up with a portfolio weighting scheme. So in this case here, that's the simple version that Gauthier mentioned in the beginning from my PhD work. In the simple version, you just split the amount of capital accordingly to the split. So you always have a 50-50 split of capital at each intersection here. So obviously when the tree is very deep here, you have low weights, and here the tree is not so deep. So it has different kind of weighting. So I call this sometimes also the waterfall approach. You could also call it hierarchical equal weight. And it's very simple. And the extension, or not extension, but the more the risk parity approach is the hierarchical by Lopez de Prado. So in this case, you have the first step here. So it's the same. You have the covariance correlation matrix, and you do this reordering of the matrix by applying this dendrogram hierarchical cluster structure just to flip the rows and columns. And then you can already see here the block correlations here. So that's the first step of HRP. And the second step basically is to execute a naive risk parity inverse volatility weighting scheme at each level of this tree. Yeah, so in the first level, you split your data into bisection, and you measure the risk of the left-hand side and the right-hand side of the portfolio, and you distribute the capital according to the inverse risk of these two sub-portfolios. And then you continue, you do the next splitting B section wise, and you do this procedure recursively, iteratively, until you reach the low level branches here, which is the single security level. Yeah, so this is basically hierarchical risk parity. And as I mentioned before, we took some multi-asset data set, 20 years of futures, and then we created around 100,000 bootstrap or block bootstrap samples. So it's like a random drawing with repetition. So here in this case, for example, this block here appears twice, and this block never occurs. Yeah, so you can really generate simple scenarios basically with this with same distributions as the original one. Sorry. And because we use blocks here, we can maintain the correlation properties among the assets, which is important, obviously. And then we measure the performance of these 100,000 block bootstrap data set, the performance actually of hierarchical risk parity and equal risk contribution. And the performance in this case, we measure with the Kalmar ratio, could also be Sharpe ratio. The Kalmar is like a return over drawdown. So you have also the asymmetric drawdown risk measure inside the Kalmar. So, and this is the distribution, and we can see that the HRP is really dominating the performance. So in most of the cases here, we see that HRP is much better performance than equal risk contribution, okay? And the next step is to take each of these 100,000 data sets and measure some properties of the data sets. For example, the average correlation, the average risk, the average return, the drawdowns, and all these things. So we get a lot of features that describe the statistical properties of this data. That's the training data. And the labels are basically the outperformance. So we call this the Kalmar spread. Yeah, so, and then you can train an XGBoost model or any other machine learning model, then apply the SHAP approach, and you get a global weighting of the variable importance. So in this case here, we had the maximum drawdown SD. So that means the standard deviation of maximum drawdowns across the input futures. So it's around 18 futures. So we measure the volatility or the variability of maximum drawdowns of these futures. So this was the most important feature. Second most important was a subset of futures, which were only covering fixed income. Remember, the data set was multi-asset with three or four asset classes. So we really get interesting results here. So obviously the max drawdown is an important measure, the variability or heterogeneity in a portfolio. If it's high, it helps the HRP algorithm. And the same applies here to the fixed income measures. And then you can proceed and cluster and visualize the SHAP values as mentioned in the first use case. So it's the same pipeline, it's the same workflow as before. And you can imagine you can run a lot of experiments here and compare a lot of strategies. And the only thing that we were not so much satisfied here was the fact that we used these bootstrap series. And we want to have more, exotic scenarios. So this was the point where I saw the work and read and study the work more in depth of Gauthier's, the CoreGAN approach, which is a generative adversarial network approach to produce correlation matrices that have the same properties and stylized facts as true empirical ones, which is really useful, I think. And so we had we took from his paper the stylized facts of empirical correlation matrices, which are, for example, the distribution of pairwise correlations in an empirical correlation matrix is shifted to the positive. So we have an average positive correlation. And there are some properties also regarding the eigenvalues. So in a market portfolio, you have probably something like a very large eigenvalue, first eigenvalue, which is the market, and a couple of other large eigenvalues, which could be the industries, for examples, for example, in, let's say, S&P data set. And also some other properties have been studied in the literature that you can find in empirical correlation market matrices of financial markets, which is also the hierarchical structure of correlations. There's very often hierarchical structure that can be observed, and also the corresponding minimal spanning tree has certain properties in terms of the links and the link structure. It's also scale free, so you have few nodes that have many links and very many new nodes that have only few links, basically. So these properties we put into an algorithm and a multi-objective evolutionary algorithm and made each of these stylized facts one of the objectives. So we have the opportunity to optimize these as a constraint or as an objective and create a lot of new solutions, like a population of correlation matrices that can be displayed in this way. So each bar here basically is one objective, and each line that goes through it is one member of this population representing one correlation matrix. So this is basically which is not that data intense, because you just need one empirical data set to produce fake, let's say, correlation matrices. So they have the same properties or similar ones as the empirical ones, and these can be the basis for doing Monte Carlo experiments and apply this basically to this framework that I introduced before. So you have a richer amplified input data set, better than the bootstrap version, basically.